Good morning, everyone. My name is Prabhat Jayashankar. I'm a fellow foreign policy here at Brookings, India. I'll just call up my chairman to make the introduction in just a minute. But before I do so, I just want to make a few announcements. One, we have a few photographers in the room. I'd like to request all photographers to please only take photographs during the first 5 minutes and not for the rest of the event. It will be quite disruptive. Also, for the videographers in the room, please do not move up and down. If you could please remain stationary over the course of the lecture, that would be very much appreciated. And finally, if I could remind everybody to please turn off their cell phones so they don't ring during the lecture. Thank you. Without further ado, let me introduce Victor Mehta, who is chairman of Brookings India.
Morning, everyone. I'm delighted to welcome you all to Brookings India. I'm honored to welcome you, Your Excellency, to this first ambassadorial lecture. Thank you very much for taking the time off to be with us. Yeah, we all know that we live in my view, dangerous times. Some people might say it's interesting times. Most people would probably suggest it's unpredictable times. But in my view, I have never seldom seen a world where the likelihood of misperceptions, miscalculations, and paranoia can lead to an accidental catastrophe. Just a sweep of the world reveals how we're all caught up in a spiral of violence and incoherence. But Venezuela is on the brink of a coup, certainly in the middle of domestic strife. Major countries in Africa are facing economic problems. The Middle East seems to be in free fall, suffering from sectarian and other issues. Only this morning, I read in the papers about China's involvement in the Indian Ocean and across in the South China Sea. Who knows where they're and what are their aspirations? I can go on, but everything somehow or the other coalesces in this part of the world and in Afghanistan. The actors are different, but there's kind of a great game being played out now in Afghanistan. I mean, we've all read about the mother of all bombs. We know what the consequences, but we don't know what the consequences of that will be. We also just recently heard about the tragic sort of killing of over 100 Afghan military people by the Taliban. This is very dangerous, and there can be no more, I think, crucial time for India and Afghanistan to develop a strategic relationship. I know that India is deeply involved in helping, partnering Afghanistan on the economic front, on the cultural side. We are supporting the construction of Afghanistan's parliament. But there are so many issues. And we in Brookings are deeply grateful to His Excellency Ambassador Shaida Abdali for having taken the time off to provide us a perspective of the issues that roil this country, that roil the region. And I am really once again grateful to all of you to come here in the morning, early in the morning in a sense. Ambassador Abdali was born in Kandahar, and he joined the government after the fall of the Taliban in 2001 as an aide to President Karzai. Subsequently, he became the Deputy National Security Advisor of Afghanistan, and this was before he took over. He took this position as ambassador to India. He has been involved in high-level negotiations between his government and the United States in particular, and I don't think there is a better person to give us a perspective on the nature of the relationship between India and Afghanistan, the problems that the region faces, and possibly the roadmap ahead. Thank you very much again, and may I invite His Excellency to give his address.
Well, a very good morning, Mr. Chairman, distinguished friends, media, Mr. Shankar, ladies and gentlemen. I'm really honored to be invited to the inaugural ambassadorial series of your institute's events. I must congratulate you for that. And before I start on the topic, you can see here strengthening India-Afghanistan strategic relations in an uncertain world. I'll begin by expressing our condolences over the last of over 20 Indian police in yesterday's attack. But regardless of the causes, we lose our people, we lose our police and the army in our countries. Now coming to the topic under discussion. Since it is more on India-Afghanistan relations, I'll focus more on the topic and then go on to some of other dimensions that relates to our two countries' relationship, as was indicated by Mr. Singh, how unpredictable, uncertain the world we live in. There's, I don't think, much need to introduce the old civilizational, deep, time-tested relations of India and Afghanistan. It's a well-known story of not only our people, but a story among the globe, to see how close, how cordial our relationship is, and how strategic this relationship is. And this relationship, as you all know, has been founded by the people of the two countries. That's more significant. After all, we're nations. It's the people that determine our destinies. And it's the people that have given us this strategic relationship of our two great nations. And now this civilization relationship was transformed into a strategic in October 2011 under an agreement called Afghanistan-India Strategic Partnership Agreement. And India was the first strategic ally of Afghanistan. Let me repeat. India was the first strategic partner of Afghanistan after the fall of the Taliban. And we have, after signing the agreement with India, we entered into strategic partnership agreements with many other countries around the world. And we're pleased to see our country entering into strategic partnerships in the region and beyond. And we're grateful to India for being the largest donor in the region and the fifth largest donor in the world in the reconstruction of Afghanistan after the fall of the Taliban, with $3 billion already committed to Afghanistan. And this partnership agreement includes areas of cooperation from politics to economy, to trade to culture, and to security. It includes all of these areas. And it's an ongoing process of further deepening and strengthening our two countries' relationship. The fact that Prime Minister Modi visited twice last year Afghanistan shows the depth and the importance that all two countries give to one another. And he was there to inaugurate the Afghan Parliament, the Salma Dam, and the Stored Palace, one of the oldest buildings of Afghanistan in our foreign ministry. And not only that we're only strengthening our relationship, we're also working on expanding our relationship to other neighbors of Afghanistan. Trade-wise, as you all know, it was Prime Minister Modi with his strong commitment to expand our relationship to other countries of the region. We were able to sign the Chabahar Transit Trade Agreement recently. And let me give you a little bit of information on the achievement of the past 16 years in Afghanistan. In each of the achievements that I will talk about, India has a stake. India has a contribution in the achievements that we've had in the last 16 years, from development to education, to infrastructure, to trade and commercial ties, to the achievements in communication, to democracy, and to security. I know we will have a lengthy session toward the end of the Q&A. I'll briefly go over some of the important projects that we've had in the last 16 years. For example, education. From almost no education in 2001, today we have millions of our children in school. From almost no credible university in Afghanistan, today we have over 200 public and private universities in Afghanistan. From almost no student studying outside Afghanistan, today we have only in India about 16,000 studying in India. Apart from that, the construction of around 4,000 kilometers of road in Afghanistan. The Zaranjilaram road built by India. Electricity to Kabul city. Never before in the history of Afghanistan, Kabul had a permanent electricity. Today we have that with the cooperation of India. And a number of development projects, small, medium, and large. And Salma Dam is one recent example. In communication, from no mobile before in the history of Afghanistan when we came after the Taliban, today a country of a population around 30 million, today 20 million mobile users in the country. More than 60 TV channels, over 200 newspapers. And you can see our democracy. No country can develop in democracy without deficiencies, without problems. And Afghanistan is not an exception. But we are proud to see our democracy coming fast. We've had a number of elections, presidential and parliamentary, and we'll soon be witnessing another round of presidential and parliamentary election. Security. Afghanistan National Security Forces 3 years ago took over the responsibility of our people in Afghanistan in terms of their protection and security. from no army and no police. Today we have about 352,000 army and police. NATO, our allies, the US, are continuing to commit to the further strengthening of the Afghan security forces under the NATO resolute mission, which remains focused on training, advising, and assisting the Afghan national security forces. But we continue to seek further capacity for our national security forces. And we seek that assistance all over the world, including India. As we all know, our relationship, as I said earlier, with India is very comprehensive. It includes all areas of cooperation, including security. We have over 4,000 officers of the Afghan National Security Forces trained in India, an average of 300 officers under training each time. And we're planning of at least 50% increase of our training program in India. And we're very hopeful that we'll be soon announcing the decision over the 50% increase of our forces training in India. But unfortunately, you all know Afghanistan went through some of the toughest years after the fall of the Taliban, including the toughest last summer and the toughest beginning of this summer. But our forces are resilient, our people are resilient to commit to the protection and defense of their country. And we owe our gains to all our international partners, including India, for all the achievements that we've had in the last 16 years, including in the national security forces. But we know that reconstruction of Afghanistan, comprised of all what we need to do in Afghanistan as a state to have institutions strong enough, it is not the task of one country. It is the task of many countries around the world, which is the case right now. India is a great partner in that joint effort to reconstruct Afghanistan, to strengthen the Afghan state institutions so that Afghanistan stands on its own feet. We have future plans for further deepening our relationship. For the press, for you to know that we, in May, we're going to have the second Partnership Council meeting under this partnership agreement that we have with India. The first one in 2012, and we will be in May holding the second Partnership Council meeting in India, chaired by our two foreign ministers. That is a forum that reviews and decides on a number of issues under the partnership agreement for the implementation of a number of projects, including security, political, economic, and cultural. But currently, the $1 billion that India provided Afghanistan has focused on three main areas, including rehabilitation of our refugees coming back, irrigation, and training programs. But as I said earlier, Afghanistan's reconstruction process is not a task of one or two countries. We have a number of regional and global initiatives. Originally, we're busy with a number of friends to realize our peace efforts. But as you all know, unfortunately, we have not made much progress so far, but we continue to engage our regional partners, our neighbors, to realize our peace efforts. The peace efforts include our quadrilateral, including Afghanistan, China, US, and Pakistan. The recent initiatives taken by other countries such as Moscow. But I'm coming to that later on to assess what are expectations and what are views around the world on that new initiative. Regionally, a number of economic projects like TAPI, Silk Road, SAR, or Asia Process, SU, and so on. Internationally, we've had a number of conferences in Afghanistan, the Warsaw Conference, the Brussels, and a number of other initiatives that we have and are planning to have in the future. But in the midst of all these commitments, assurances, and achievement that we have challenges, major challenges. The biggest challenge is terrorism that hinders our efforts towards realizing the vision that we all collectively have. The terrorism as a tool used against Afghanistan, against India, and a number of countries around the world. And as you all know, we have a number of terrorist groups, and I'm not going to go into the details of those all groups. I'm going to focus on the new phenomena called Daesh. This is the phenomena that we're facing, the most dangerous phenomena that we face, and the fallouts and the dangers and the effects that we feel in our countries, including in Afghanistan. But our forces, as I said earlier, are committed to fight, and they are fighting this most brutal phenomena as well in Afghanistan. And we've made a lot of progress in terms of dealing with Daesh. But we still hope that countries around the region and the world will help Afghanistan deal with this most dangerous phenomena that we face in Afghanistan today, and will eventually spill over to the rest of the region and beyond. But as Mr. Singh said earlier, we are in an unpredictable world. And he also said we are in a new great game. And I agree. In the midst of all these problems, we also see us being in a very unpredictable and uncertain world. But this new great game is played on a number of levels. Mainly, I would say three levels. A great game fought between intelligence agencies, the ideological war, and the actual war. But how we can say that we are in an uncertain world? As we all know, the world is changing. We all witness the rapid growth of China, a much stronger India, a resurgent Russia, an active role of Japan, division in Gulf, a divided Europe, and overstretched US have made the world order difficult and uncertain. But Asia suffered the most in this game. From violent extremism to criminal economies and to state sponsorship of terrorism. But the fatigue and reluctance towards enhancing common regional trade, transit, and connectivity by certain countries are the biggest threat to our collective peace and prosperity in the region. So how India and Afghanistan respond? The world of unpredictability to the world that we are in, which is so uncertain. And we also call this world in the context of new normal, the multipolarity and the multilateralism. And we should also look at the same time, while speaking of fears, distress of the world that we are increasingly getting in, we should also be optimistic about this world turning into an opportunity. And we hope that countries in this region, Asia, in partnership with the rest of the world, will utilize the opportunity that will be given to us in the context of the great game, that we can play better, which will translate into a better Asia, a peaceful and prosperous Asia. And that will only be achieved on the basis of learning from our mistakes and building on the win-win objectives at the regional level and at the global level. To summarize the durable solution of a destructive war imposed on Afghanistan and the effects with the rest of the world, mainly India. First, there should be no substitute for state-to-state relationships. Second, there should be sincere regional cooperation in continued partnership with the international community for peace and security in the region, mainly in Afghanistan. Third, regional consensus on the long-term stabilization of Afghanistan as a common good in support of an Afghan-led, an Afghan peace effort. Fourth, no duplicity and no selectivity in defining terrorism. In other words, using one terror against the other is the only way, is what we see as a management, not a solution to the problem that we all seek. Fifth, India and Afghanistan need to have a strategic review of their bilateral, regional, and global partnerships in order to deal with the evolving, unpredictable, and uncertain world. Sixth, we have had a number of partnership agreements, but I hope that India, Afghanistan, and the US will operationalize this trilateral strategic dialogue in order for the three of us to find a durable solution to the problem that we all three see as a common. And more importantly, prioritize peace against a self-defeating zero-sum mentality. And accept Afghanistan as a point of collaboration over confrontation. Finally, the terrorists, and particularly the state sponsorship of terrorism, should be conveyed a strong message that they will never be able to win militarily. And I fully support recent statement of General McMaster, the US National Security Advisor, that those who seek their strategic goals through violence, they should stop, and they should seek their objectives through diplomacy, not through proxies. In conclusion, the future security of Afghanistan will depend on a holistic and sincere fight against terrorism at the regional and the global level. A strong Afghan state will have the most important role to realize that shared goal. India, in the context of Afghanistan's foreign policy, will continue to hold a strategic place in all areas of cooperation. Thank you very much.